The Embraer 195 has many quirky and weird features and is a completely unique and interesting aircraft. Prior to my Embraer 195 type rating, I have flown with two different aircrafts during the course of my training. One being the Fokker 100 and the other one being the Airbus A320. I feel very fortunate to have that little experience of just 28 hours in each aircraft, but for me, it's fascinating and interesting to see how different kinds of aircraft types are designed and what philosophies they follow. So while it's all still fresh and new from the type rating theory class of my Embraer 195, this is Flo and welcome to Fordeck. Here is a breakdown of what I think are the most interesting and quirky features of the E-Jet family. The Embraer 195 is a fly-by-wire aircraft. Well, almost. The 170, 175, 190 and 195, from which I'm gonna now refer to as E-Jets, is a fly-by-wire aircraft except for the ailerons. The ailerons are conventionally controlled by pulleys and cables, just like in your Cessna 172. The E-Jets family was formally launched on 14th of June 1999 at the Paris Air Show. The launch customer for the family were the French airline Regional, which placed 10 orders and 5 options for the 170, and the Swiss airline Crossair, which had ordered 30 E-170s and 30 E-190s. In July 2000, production of components for the construction of both prototypes and test airframes began. Difficulties with the advanced avionics selected for the aircraft, supplied by the American company Honeywell, led to delays in the early stages of the development and certification. Now, you see, this delay put immense pressure on the company, with initial launch customer waiting on the jet or otherwise looking towards a more readily available option. And this meant that the ailerons had to be conventionally controlled, as fly-by-wire implementation of the ailerons only could have meant cancelled orders with its launch customer, as the launch date would have been delayed even more. The new E2 version of the E-Jets family is fully fly-by-wire. By the way, the new fly-by-wire ailerons means a weight saving of 200 kilograms as a lightening of the wing structure was possible. Plus, the new ailerons can also be used as aerodynamic braking, just like the multifunction roll spoilers, avoiding larger wheels and brakes. The Embraer 195 is actually longer than an Airbus A320. While the maximum takeoff mass, seat capacity and general size are less than that of an A320, the Embraer 195 being the longest one of the family is actually longer than an A320, surpassing it by approximately 1 meter with a length of 38.65 meters. However, because the cabin is configured in a 2+2 configuration, the seat capacity is less than in the A320, with only 120 seats in the Embraer compared to about 160 seats to 180 seats in the Airbus A320. The Embraer 195 has highly advanced avionics. Compared to other aircraft, the E-Jet was developed fairly recently. For instance, the A320 had its first flight in 1984, while the 737 had its maiden in 1997. Honeywell, as Embraer's main supplier of avionic components, is actually known for its share in general aviation and business jet technology. And if you follow that channel, you know that business jets have always the newest and shiniest tech. Embraer's MCDU is actually pretty advanced, especially with the new software update called Epic Load 27, costing airlines over $1 million to install. The Embraer has some highly advanced and comfortable to use features. First off, the primary flight display now looks like this. Sick. Why get a software update for your fleet of airliners and expect the display units 1 and 5 to look the same? Like iPhone, they changed their design. But more importantly, the update will have features like a third FMA row, which displays information about flight director modes during non-precision approaches, a default map and plan selection checked. Previously, the pilot had to select all of them with every startup. The navigation database cycle is switched automatically. Engine out SID is automatically loaded into the flight plan if engine out mode is activated and only needs to be activated by the pilots. Idle descents are now possible. Previously, the pilots had to enter a descent angle and the thrust was not always idle. Now the pilots can enter wind speeds for various levels they are descending through and can get an idle descent towards the approach. And levels with expected icing conditions during descent can be inserted as well, as the Embraer will command a way higher flight idle setting when icing conditions are detected, which will decrease your descent angle. FMS speed can now be used from takeoff to landing, which is kind of like managed speed with the Airbus. Speed green dots can be used during the approach, which represents the minimum speed in the current configuration and not the minimum clean speed like it is the case with the Airbus. CPDLC, which is a digital data link that replaces in some situations the voice air traffic control, now offers directs straight into the flight plan page. So if ATC gives you a direct towards a waypoint, the MCDU will give you the option to activate that direct straight in the flight plan page, which is pretty convenient. A bar illuminated on a button means non-normal position of that particular button. So when everything is dark, plus all selector knobs are in the 12 o'clock position, everything is normal. If a button is pushed out, for instance, the engine R1 ice protection button, this means the engine 1 ice protection system will not operate either in auto or manual mode. Speaking of the ice protection system, the E-Jet family has a fully automatic ice protection system. If an ice detector detects icing conditions, anti-ice system for both the engines and wheel will be automatically activated. An indication that the system is operative is displayed on the ICAS CAS. On the ground, the engine and anti-ice system has to be activated manually if ice conditions exist, as the ice detector cannot detect ice without any airflow over the detector. It can be activated via the overhead panel or the MCDU. During takeoff, that is from ground level up to 1,700 feet or 2 minutes, whichever is earlier, the ice detection system is disregarded and the anti-ice system will be controlled by the takeoff data set menu on the MCDU. Either the engine anti-ice only or engine plus wing anti-ice can be selected, which will then be active to 1,700 feet above ground level. After that, the system will then revert to its default control logic with the ice detector. That means if no visible moisture exists and the anti-ice is selected off in the MCDU, there won't be any anti-ice system active up to a height of 1,700 feet, even if ice is sensed via the probes. Automatic or manual activation of the anti-ice system will lead to a higher flight idle thrust setting. Because of that, during descent, expected icing conditions have to be anticipated to account for the shallower descent that the aircraft will be able to fly because of the higher idle thrust setting. Additionally, the anti-ice system will be active after icing conditions are left to melt any residual ice on the wings and the engines. This also means a higher idle thrust setting. In the worst case, speed brakes would have to be used to keep the prior calculated descent path. The automatic activation when airborne will always switch on the engine and wing anti-ice all at once if ice is sensed, the engine anti-ice and the wing anti-ice. A flight guidance you have to get used to. The flight director used in the Embraer is a little dot you'll try to catch with the birdie, so you will never actually really look at your pitch attitude again. With traditional flight directors used in the Embraer for takeoff only, you will set your pitch to whatever the flight director is guiding you to. With our special flight director, you will set the flight path of the aircraft towards the little dot. The flight path is not actually your pitch and will be during a normal 3-degree approach below the horizontal line, while your pitch will be more than 0 degrees. You really have to get used to this in the beginning, and you sometimes have to force yourself to look at the pitch, otherwise you never really look at it except at takeoff, which is a pitch-based maneuver with crossbars. Even with the flight director off, you will still have the birdie displayed, as we call it. The birdie will show you the flight path, so if you fly level, it will be at the 0-degree line. During descent, it will be below 0 degrees, and during climb, above. I think you get the concept. During any kind of approach, let's say a 3-degree approach, you can set a 3-degree reference line in your PFD or HGS and set your fly path on that reference line. This will get you an exact 3-degree glide path towards the runway. The HGS is the head-up guidance system. With this system, it is extremely easy to fly precisely. Very small corrections are made on the HGS. During the last portion of an ILS approach, the HGS will declutter and you lose your airspeed band and altitude band. Those primary values will still be shown, but only in numbers next to the birdie. Something to get used to. There's a little line and a chevron next to the birdie which indicates your acceleration and deceleration rate, plus how far off you actually are from the airspeed target set in the guidance panel. So you actually never really have to look at the airspeed tape, as corrections can be made completely based on this indication. With the HGS system, the captain is able to land manually with a runway visual range of 200 meters, plus a decision height of as little as 50 feet, which is pretty cool. Controlling your display units with a touchpad. You've probably noticed it already. On the center pedestal, there is a cursor control device located, one for each pilot. On this device, you can move a cursor, just like on your computer on the iCast, to scroll to cast messages during abnormal conditions. The MFD to select options for map and plan view and to scroll through the system pages. And the PFD for an auxiliary way to tune frequencies in case the MCDU fails. On the left and right, you have a select button. On top, you will have two wheels to scroll through the flight plan view or to scroll through multiple cast messages. You definitely have to get used to it. And for the system page selections, I prefer the way that Airbus did it, with a soft button for each system page. But you know, it looks like a Ferrari, drives like a Fiat. At least that's what all the instructors are telling us. But it looks pretty advanced, and the A350 has a similar system, so it has to be pretty cool. A guarded button you use every day. On the center pedestal, you will find a door control panel with a lock button to activate the electromechanical lock for the cockpit door. According to Embraer logic, the button is in its normal position, pushed in without a wide bar illuminated, and the door is locked. But to lock or unlock the door, you will have to lift the guard. In our operation, we would operate that button up to 10 times a day, so the hesitancy of lifting a guard and just pushing the button will definitely wear off after some time. That's what a guard is actually there for. A guarded button is usually a button with irreversible action. A button you would usually have to think twice before pressing it, plus confirming the action by the other pilot. But because you operate this guarded button on a daily basis, guarded buttons are just part of the normal day-to-day operation. Speaking of the cockpit door, from the outside, when the cockpit is locked and the aircraft has no electrical power, no one is getting into the flight deck. So in case of a crash landing with no electrical power left and both pilots unconscious, the flight attendants will not be able to help us get out and evacuate the potentially dangerous aircraft. Of course, that except scenario with both pilots incapacitated is very unlikely to happen, but it still is a possibility. In the Airbus, the door is automatically unlocked with no electrical power to it. Ferry flights require ballast weight. When no passengers or cargo are loaded onto the aircraft, the CG limits are tighter than usual due to the light take of weight of the aircraft. In this case, we can either load sandbags into the forward cargo hold, each weighing about 50 kilograms, or we can use ballast fuel. Now, ballast fuel is a fuel that can never be used for flying, as it would mean an exceedance of the center of gravity and flight envelope. It is stored just like the trip fuel in the integral wing tanks, and by increasing the overall weight of the aircraft, CG limits will widen and it is possible to take off, provided that the ballast fuel is not used. Engine shutdown protection. N1 operative engine minimum 5% above N1 idle. Why is this one of the first items in our engine out checklist? This helps us to not shut down the wrong, in our case, living engine. The engine cannot be shut down if the N1 indication is more than 5% above idle. Let's say you have an engine failure during an idle descent. In this case, with both throttles at the idle descent, you would disengage the auto throttle and you would then have to increase the living engine to at least 5% above idle to positively complete that item on the QRH checklist. There's also a warning depicted on the QRH not to move the operative engine thrust lever to idle for at least 1 minute after selecting the start stop selector to stop. This is part of the shutdown protection. Flight control modes. Just like Airbus with its flight control laws, Embraer has flight control laws as well, called flight control modes. Although not sophisticated in the Airbus, control mode normal mode will assist the pilot during normal operation with its high level functions. For instance, the elevator has, when operating in normal mode, a function called elevator thrust compensation. Now, with underwing mounted engines, any thrust increase, so that means in this direction, vector in this direction, will automatically pitch up the aircraft. And with this function, trim adjustments are automatically made when the thrust lever angle is increased, provided the elevators are in normal mode. Even when the autopilot is disengaged, this function is active. The system can be deactivated for its flight control with a high-level function on the top of the center pedestal. In direct mode, the flight control module is removed from the control loop and high-level functions are lost. Some other high-level functions provided by the flight control modules include, but are not limited to, elevator, rudder and spoiler control, or scheduling with airspeed, which means a higher airspeed will give you less authority. Configuration change compensation with elevators and horizontal stabilizers due to landing gear, flap slat and speed brake actuation. Arming of the speed brake. In the Airbus, the speed brake lever has to be moved into the arm position for landing and reject takeoff. In the Embraer, the speed brake will deploy automatically, which is here, and does not have to be armed or stowed after landing. These conditions must be met for ground spoiler deployment, weight on wheels, thrust lever angle at flight idle, wheel speed above 45 knots or airspeed above 60 knots, and it will automatically retract at a wheel speed below 45 knots. Even during a touch and go landing, the speed brakes will deploy and will only retract again if the thrust levers are advanced to more than 70 degrees of thrust lever angle. I hope you like my breakdown of the E-Jet system. I'm not a type writing instructor, I'm just a type writing student who looked up all those numbers and facts for this very video, and of course, I studied it as well. Nevertheless, if you have any questions or comments about the chat, leave them in the comments below and I will look them up and answer them as best as I can. Or even if you are a pilot actually flying the Embraer and you have some additional fun facts about the chat, write it down in the comments below. Until the next one, stay safe.